Welcome to the Washington County Commissioner District 3 Candidates Forum. My name is Marguerite Reinberger, also known as Margo. This forum is sponsored by the Stillwater Gazette. Jonathan Young, the managing editor of the Stillwater Gazette, will have this forum answers written up on October 17th edition of the Stillwater Gazette. In alphabetical order, the two candidates running for this office are David Baudette and Gary Kriesel. Thank you both for coming. During this 45-minute forum, both of you will be invited to give up to a minute and a half opening, minute and a half closing, and up to a minute and a half to address the questions. If time allows, I will offer you, or you can request of me, a one-minute rebuttal if your opponent refers to him, yourself, one of you, in the response. So you to David, gave it to you. In that case, I get the final discretion, and I may actually move the rebuttal down to 30 if I feel that we're overboard on the topic, but you certainly will have the opportunity to request it. Maya Jokanovic is key here, timekeeper. She'll hold up cards that say 1 minute, 30 seconds, 15 seconds, and stop. When Maya holds up stop, she's going to yell stop, and I'm actually going to cut you right off at that point. So it's best to be paying attention to Maya, and therefore you'll be able to address the viewers at home on that camera as well as the view, as, instead of me, because I'm not the only player here. And it's just easier to watch her, so we have good timing on this forum. Finally, those attending in person, please save your applause for the end and refrain from whispering. And the order, who talks first and last, is determined in forms that I do in what I call reverse alphabetical order, which means Gary Kriesel will be the first to do the intro, the first to answer the first question, and the last to do the closing. Let's begin with your opening, Gary Kriesel. Please introduce yourself.
Well, good morning, and thank you to the Stillwater Gazette for sponsoring this debate and to Margo Reinberger for moderating, and thank you to those in the audience and watching at home. As Margo said, I'm Commissioner Gary Kriesel. I grew up in Stillwater, and I've spent most of my life in the St. Croix Valley. I currently live in Stillwater with my wife, Ann. We'll be celebrating our 50th wedding anniversary this December. I have three great daughters and seven wonderful grandchildren. I enjoy spending time with family and watching the grandkids play sports. I'm a big supporter of the Stillwater Ponies. I'm a proud Navy veteran, and I served on the same ship as my brother, Niall. After the Navy, I got a job at Northern States Power, XL Energy. I worked there for 33 years and finished up as a senior area specialist in the gas division. After retiring, I served 2 years on the Stillwater City Council. I was first elected Washington County Commissioner in 2004. It has been an honor representing the people of District 3. During my time in office, I have built positive relationships with citizens, business owners, and community leaders in Washington County and beyond. I have received overwhelming support from residents and leaders, including the endorsement of all 12 mayors and town board chairs in District 3, who urged me to run again. I've also been endorsed by Labor, ASME, and the St. Paul Regional Federation of Labor, AFL-CIO. I look forward to building on those relationships.
Thank you. And David Baudette.
Good morning. I'd like to thank the Stillwater Gazette for holding the forum, the audience members, the viewers at home. David Baudette, born and raised in Oak Park Heights, Stillwater Area High School graduate, 1970. And a BA in Humanities from Metro State University. Worked in business, started several companies in the oil industry in the 80s, 70s and 80s, and in the 90s achieved a patent. I have been involved in politics on the Oak Park Heights City Council for 17 years, the last 12 years as mayor, on various boards appointed to the Metropolitan Council Land Advisory Board, and have many, many partnerships with, for instance, the Oak Park Elementary School Playground, which was able to be built by the three communities that had children going to Oak Park Elementary School, and also working with very hard on making sure that the city of Oak Park Heights did not have to pay the full weight of the utility costs to its community. The city is going to have to pay $1 million in utility costs. It did receive $2.3 million. It also had to pay $500,000 for a frontage road. which is unacceptable burden to the city. Thank you.
Thank you, and I'll begin the first question with Gary. When it comes to providing and maintaining a robust system of county roads, is the county doing its job well? What, if anything, would you change?
Well, that's a great question, Margo, and I appreciate it. I believe the county is doing an outstanding job. All you have to do is drive around District 3 and take a look at all the projects that are underway. It's the county, their highest priority is to keep our roadways safe and in good repair. So there's not much I would do differently. We have a great professional staff, great engineering, award-winning engineers, and we're going to continue. One of the things is when the new St. Croix River crossing opens up, obviously it's going to change traffic patterns. And immediately opening of the bridge, we'll be conducting a comprehensive regional traffic study so we can adjust for any improvements that's necessary. I think we can all agree that downtown Stillwater is no longer going to be invaded with transient traffic and backs up and things like that. We're going to have nice neighborhoods, quiet neighborhoods, and not just Stillwater, but Oak Park Heights and Bayport. Cars are backed up all the way to the Bayport cutoff, up Myrtle Street, up 3rd Street, St. Michael's Church. So, yeah, we're prepared for the future. We got a lot more coming.
Thank you. And David?
Well, I would say that the county has done as well as a good a job as it can with providing adequate transportation. It certainly, we need the courage of the state to actually raise the gas tax. The last bond issue that the county issued this year, $17.5 million of the $20 million went to roads. So that's quite a subsidy on property tax owners to build roads. Secondly, we need to build safe roads. Hilton Trail exit is a disaster. The traffic in rush hour backs up almost onto Highway 36, creating the real danger. That's a project that the county participated with money and should never been approved by the county. For those that live in the northwest corner of the city of Stillwater, they know about this traffic disaster. You have to stop at the roundabout at the bottom of the ramp in order to see the traffic from the left. And then lastly, let's take Highway 15 from 36 to 96. Think if you travel that road for the last 5 years, where you've had four major construction projects on it. What kind of county can't build 3 miles of road at one time? How much extra cost did it come to bring the equipment every year, or nearly every year, to come out there and rebuild a small section of the road? Last year was about 1/4 mile. This year it's the roundabout. Why not bring the equipment there all one time? Save taxpayer dollars, make the projects cost efficient. We can tell the way the projects are done, the county's under strain financially.
Stop.
Okay. Since Gary Creasel was involved in some of those decisions, would you like a minute rebuttal?
Well, I would. Thank you very much. The fact of the matter is Highway 36 and Hilton Trail is a state project. It's funded by the state. The county commented on it, but they're not paying for the improvements there, and when you come to scheduling, there's a lot of things that influence it. Roundabouts, it takes a permitting, a lead time, things like that. I think we do a good job on bringing forward projects.
And I am going to give David the final 1 minute on this.
The county participated with dollars to the Hilton Trail exit, and therefore had a greater role and greater say into making sure that that exit was safe. That's a county-state project.
State
Thank
project.
You. David, I'll begin the next question with you. What is your view of mass transit projects? How should the county be involved in planning and financing these projects, if at all?
Well, the one nice thing about transit is that Minnesota doesn't have an oil well within 500 miles of this district. Therefore, every time we make our transportation system more efficient, every Minnesotan becomes wealthier. So having transit, or having the transit ability in our neighborhoods back to St. Paul, make a world of difference in terms of easing the congestion on our roads in a more cost-effective way than you being in a car all by itself. Now, the county already has, by the state, the 1/4-cent sales tax, which adequately funds, or nearly adequately funds transit, but not in our area. We need to improve the transit, especially as we, as a community, age, because as a community ages, they're going to want transportation options, and that's what we need to do, have those options. We need to have some transit. We do need more funding, whether that's more of the sales tax or not, but we need to continue on our efforts with transit and transit funding.
Thank you. And Gary?
I somewhat agree with David's response. I voted in 2008 against joining CTIB, the Transit Advisory or Investment Board, because I felt that building out transit should be a state, fall under the state authority. They have the power of the pen. They should be looking at it regionally. They have the authority to take transit back and put it in competition, so to speak, with roads and bridges and set those priorities. County commissioners don't have that power of the pen. And I, you know, until that happens, I'm going to continue to support what we're doing so we bring back benefit to our county. And if it stays the way it's going, one of the things I worked with the Chamber of Commerce when Todd Streeter was here is looking at circulator bus options. I mean, that is the type of bus service that people are looking for around our area, is the express bus, circulator bus, regular bus routes. And I'm going to continue to work on that.
I'll begin the next question with you, Gary. The Washington County Historical Society is the only historical society in the state that does not receive annual assistance from the county where it's located, according to Brent Peterson, the Historic Society's executive director. The county eliminated its annual support 10 years ago and hasn't reinstated it. Should that change? Would you support an annual contribution to the Historical Society? And if so, how much?
Well, you know, the first and foremost, they got to bring something forward that, bring a proposal forward. Tell me what we're going to get for it. We're not going to just give out handouts, you know, and I trust me, I understand the importance of history. I love history, and I admire what they're doing, but yet, if they're looking for contribution or whatever, it's got to be go beyond just a conversation. Bring a proposal forward. Go down to Cottage Grove and get support down there, because a lot of people think it's a Stillwater Historical Society. Go up to Forest Lake, gin up that type of support, and I think that'll go a long way into you know, working with the county to see if there's some funding available. But for the most part, I'm a essential services with quality, you know, quality services at an affordable tax rate. I'm not too much into making donations at the expense of our taxpayers.
Thank you. David?
These issues where the cutting of the funds for, whether it was 4-H or the Washington County Historical Society, is a trade-off simply made by the county board. This county has been a long-term saver of dollars for the future, not borrower of the future. And so now the county has graduated to over $200 million in debt, general fund debt, which is more debt than Ramsey County has right now. Right now, about 15% of your levy, that's the policy, goes to retiring the debts of the county. Had we saved up for those projects, you know, if the county board had saved up, they may not have moved the county board from the first floor to the top floor of the building at probably $15 million of expense. But we would have been able to, by saving up, by not having to waste the nearly $50 million of future interest payments over the next 15 years, we would have been able to restore the 4-H cuts of about $75,000. We could restore the cut that was made to the Washington County Historical Society. Those are ongoing expenditures that were meaningless to the $75 million budget. Those are very important programs. Maybe not everybody knows that they are ongoing for the entire county, but they are important.
Thank you. Mr. Kreisel has asked for a rebuttal, which I'll grant.
Thank you, because the fact of the matter is, Dr. Dan Dolan with the Extension Service, a very big, strong supporter of 4-H. I kept 4-H on life support during the Great Recession and asked him about my support for 4-H and the county boards. The other thing is, we do save up for debt. We do save for projects. We paid $18.5 million cash for the North Service Shop. We paid $6.5 million cash for the resource recycling. And it's not, if you're looking at the debt, you can talk about $200 million debt. You're including the interest. Fact of the matter is, in 2011, our debt was $150 million principal, and that in 2017, it's projected to be $130 million principal. And we have $40 million that we're going to pay, and that's sitting on the sidelines because we can't make that payment until after the first of the year on debt.
Thank you. And David, you got a minute.
I think that when it comes to the 4-H funding, again, the county budget, general fund budget, is about in the neighborhood of $70 million at this time. To be able to say that you could support cutting 4-H by $75,000 and didn't hurt the program, that almost was all the program. And that was the core of the program. And that set back 4-H. They're not back at the 4-H membership that they were prior to the cuts. And the funding for 4-H hasn't been restored to what it was prior to the cut or any inflationary adjustment. Also, the Ag Board isn't being supported anymore. I think that these are very small programs that add to the quality of life, give children an opportunity to be able to participate and do things that are very, very meaningful and builds confidence with young people.
Now, I know I could give more rebuttal time, but we have to get on to other topics. David, I'll begin the next question with you. County parks are a major service provided to residents. The county just spent about $1.4 million to upgrade the swimming pond at Lake Elmo Park Reserve. The Parks Division operating budget in 2016 is $2.8 million. Do you believe county spending on parks is at the right level? What, if anything, would you change?
Well, I think that the spending level is probably a little low. People tell me that there are not enough activities in the parks. And I think that, to my knowledge, there's not a good comprehensive plan in terms of looking out for the future as to where potential future parks should be. So being able to go out and buy the most important commodity of any future park, it's the land. Whether the development takes time or not, whether the dollars are there or not. But to totally capitalize a park system to be able to say on the infrastructure needs of what's required as the population grows. And I think, you know, talking about working, having good working relationships with, let's say, the Veterans Rest Camp, and that potential takeover by the county was not in good stead. There were some problems with the Veterans Rest Camp operation, but it didn't warrant the county wanting to take over the land and closing the Veterans Rest Camp. So I think that the critical thing of the parks is the plan for future land needs. What's in the northern part of the county, if there needs to be, making sure that the parcel is big enough so it can protect itself environmentally, and recognizing that by having a large piece of property, it actually raises the property values around the park, and actually then actually provides a property tax base to support the park.
Thank you. Gary, you got up to a minute and a half to address.
Thank you. Again, I think the county does an outstanding job with its parks. You know, they're supported by the Metropolitan Council because they're regional parks. A lot of funding comes from the Met Council, and we're not, you know, to propose new parks, they have to have certain requirements before they would qualify as a park. I mean, you're not going to go out and start buying 20-acre parcels of land to promote a park. But there is a long-term a planning process within our Parks Department. They do an outstanding job. I would just say that Lake Elmo Regional Park is unbelievably popular with our citizens regionally, and I think it's a gem. And the vets camp, I'm a veteran. There was a lot of rumors floating around that the county was trying to take over the vets camp. No, they were negotiations, and once vet camp said, you know, they weren't interested, you know, that I served on the Veterans Rest Camp Board.
Because I have a lot of questions, I'm going to give David, he asked for a rebuttal, but 30 seconds.
I think the one park that most people are interesting to find is that the Washtenaw County Courthouse is a park. And before Mr. Palema left this supervisory job, one of the things that has happened now, the 110 volunteers that used to operate, raise the funds to make sure the building was maintained, have all disappeared because Mr. Palema disappeared, and the running it as a park, as an entity, trying to make it cost like it never did, isn't correct.
30 seconds.
Well, that's just not factually true. I mean, we do an outstanding job. But, you know, there was a lot of threat, a lot of damage to the building that was being caused by having, what do you call it, receptions. You know, we're willing to have it open. It's the people's house. It's the icon of Washington County. We're going to make sure it's protected and open to the public. But we're not going to have events that are going to be destructive.
I must say, as a moderator, I'm enjoying this forum. Okay, I like discussion. Gary, I'll begin the next question with you. Please suggest three ways that the county could become even more efficient in its operations.
Well, I would just say that three ways is continue, continue, continue. We have just an outstanding planning force financially. We're strong, have strong fiscal management. We have the second lowest tax rate in the metro area. We are AAA bond rated by both rating agencies, Standard & Poor's and Moody's. There's only 2% of the counties in the entire nation hold that distinction. There's not much more. We're constantly looking for efficiencies. Any efficiencies we find, and there's a cost savings at the end of the year, they're putting in a mission-directed budget, and we apply those funds like we did this year to IT improvements so the taxes don't have to be raised. So, you know, there's not much more I would, you know, I just want to continue the successes that we're currently enjoying.
Thank you, and David.
One of the new reorganizations is the moving of the surveyor's office out to the county garage up on McQuan Road. But when you're providing services to the county, to the residents, it's not good that when you come to record your plat, you have to go to the recorder's office. And then, because every city still requires actual physical Mylar to sign by local elected officials, you now have to, instead of just going up to the third floor and having your survey accepted by the county surveyor's office, you now get to drive the 7 miles out into the countryside to do that. A lot of these recorders, sometimes recordings of property and transactions happen right close to the end of the closing day. So you could meet a half hour before, sign all the documents down at the recording office, all the parties, and then, oh, you can't go to the third floor and drop these off, because you have to start a lot earlier to go out, to drive out to the county shop. That's not an reorganization that's positive to the county. There are numerous examples of this. Mental health care is also another area. You know, there's no emergency hotline at night for emergency mental health care. But we don't have the emergency beds for someone to be. It's either the county jail is where someone's going to be without getting any help. These aren't efficiencies.
Maya, I'm going to give 30 seconds to Gary Kriesel, and then David will finish the topic.
Okay, real quickly, I'm not about to micromanage. I'm not the smartest man in the county that's going to tell our professional staff how they should headquarters. You know, we go through those discussions. It makes sense to me. We got to let these people do what they do best, and that's manage the business. The other thing is mental health. I totally agree. Our jails should not be used as mental health facilities, but, you know, we got to, that's controlled by the state. You know, we're mandated by the state. There's laws from set in the state.
Stop. Thank you. David, 30, finish it up if you want.
I think that, you know, on the role of mental health care, we need to make vast improvements. The county has this responsibility with the state and the federal government, where there are dollars and mandates. And I think that we need to make those improvements to which can make the community much safer so that we don't have stabbings like there was in a Bayport bar.
Ten-second response.
Is he even done with his 30?
Yep.
I didn't hear the stop. 10, but then he gets a 10 too, so go for it.
Okay, sure. I just want to point out to people, they might not know, county government is an administrative arm of the state. We administrate their mandates and services. Thank you.
It's beyond me to not understand how we can't always do more than the state. I guess if the state is going to set a minimum standard, and that's what we want to live by, I guess that's the choices we make.
Thank you. I'll begin the next question with David. The county jumped into the economic development game this year. With the Minnesota legislators' approval, the county added economic development powers to the Housing and Redevelopment Authority and renamed it the Community Development Agency. For the first time, the county has a new economic development director. What is your vision for the county in terms of promoting economic development?
Well, in 2012, we were trying to become greater MSP. MSP is an entity economically, and the chamber had a lot of meetings. We have to thank Jim Bradshaw for allowing his facility to be used to have all of those meetings happen. But at the end of the day, the county or cities were not willing to participate with dollars to actually move forward on anything. So now we have a new county EDA. Economic development still is going to reside with the townships and the cities because they control the zoning and the availability of land for economic development. And it does, and those entities also control the TIF dollars, which can be used to help with land area that's not well developed to its highest and best use become developed to its highest best use. These tools mainly reside still with the city. The county can provide a nice glossy brochure, but that's all. There can be one person that can answer the phone in terms of the county, but direct off into that individual community for land. Lastly, the county needs to plan its transportation infrastructure to really help facility. Shouldn't 95 be extended to 36?
Stop.
Thank you. And Gary.
Well, thank you. The reason the county got involved in economic development was at the request of cities after holding meetings with cities. They wanted us to expand what we normally do, and that was, you know, providing good infrastructure, roads and things that enhances economic development. Our economic development is not to trump any city's authority. We're there as a resource. We're there as a resource that they requested us. And I can't speak about it right now, but there's some great things that are going to come about. My good friend Brian Zeller, former mayor of Lakeland, he's one that give me a lot of inspiration to support this model. Like he says, you know, you need a traffic cop. Who does somebody call if they want to move into the area? Small cities don't have an economic development director on staff, so we're filling that role, and it's supportive. It's at the request of cities.
30 seconds.
Again, if we think about economic development, you know, how did Silicon Valley end up at Silicon Valley? It ended up there because the gentleman that developed the transistor with Jerry Noyce went out to Southern California and found a place that Stanford University owned and gave him a place rent-free. That's how Silicon Valley became Silicon Valley.
30 seconds.
Well, thank you, and that's exactly what we're trying to accomplish. We want entrepreneurial, we want to support that. And that's what our economic development director is going to do. We're looking for ways to assist that sort of economic development in cooperation with cities. We're not going to trump their authority.
Thank you. And I actually am taking moderator discretion because we're kind of not getting through as many questions as I had hoped, but I have enjoyed the discussion. 30 seconds on this one. I'll begin with Gary. How do you feel about the Lake Elmo Airport expansion?
Well, I there's concerns. I'm not sure that it's been fully vetted with the neighbors. I support my communities. They have concerns. It's kind of a double-edged sword. Their concern is that it's going to bring in turboprops and a lot of stuff like that. But I'll be there for to be a voice for the citizens that I represent.
Thank you. And David?
Well, I'll be a voice for the citizens if I'm elected. But I think that the airport expansion, it's not an expansion, it's actually bringing it up to current code so that for minimum runway standards, some of the noise issues will come and go because planes can't take off fully loaded and they have to take off at maximum speed because the runway is short. It really isn't going to allow for any bigger airplanes than what's currently using the facility.
Okay. And we're back to the 1.5 minute questions. David, groundwater issues continue to exist in our county. Do you feel these concerns are being adequately addressed and prevented?
Well, the two big groundwater contaminants are automobiles and individual septic systems. Automobiles are a little hard to deal with at the county level, but the septic system issue is something that I think we need to greatly improve, perhaps make a revolving loan fund and encourage people to actually come forward if they know they have a problem and see if we can do a revolving loan fund to actually get people to fix their septic systems and do it where we give the residents a 7 or a 10 year period of times until they actually have to have their septic system checked to make sure that they're meeting the code, the current codes. Because the groundwater is where the vast majority of us get all our drinking water, and without improving the septic systems, we're gonna have lakes that are gonna be in peril. We're gonna have the groundwater that gets contaminated. And if we have those industrial facilities out on septic systems, we can get those contaminants like the great Braytown groundwater plume that contaminated a great deal of water.
Thank you. Gary?
Well, David and I are in complete agreement on that. I would just add that I spearheaded getting funding from the set of the state that would enable low and no interest loans for failed septic systems. And, my goal is to expand that, to seek further funding so that if you can get it to the point where people will voluntarily have their septic systems inspected and there would be some assistance for repair. But, there's 17,000 septic systems in Washington County, and they pose, the ones that have failed pose a serious threat to our groundwater. And, I've often said that the legacy funding that is in the legislature that goes by forest lands up in northern Minnesota, I think they really should take a significant portion of that back to the metro area and take care of the pollution that's right in our own area. You can buy forest lands up north and preserve those for future generations. And I like that. But the idea is, let's address the immediate threats here.
Thank you. And Gary, I'll begin the next question with you. What is your view of the future of the county library system in light of its newly adopted strategic plan?
Well, I think the strategic plan, I call for the strategic plan. I think it's a great plan. When I called for that study, I wanted to give the citizens what they were willing to pay for, we had surveys done and things like that, and we have an outstanding library director with Keith Ruskowski. I support the plan, so.
Thank you. And David?
Well, I think there is problems with the county library system. If we think of the county library system that's going to serve the entire county, Should it be the, we should dry, everybody, every resident can have a maximum trip of 6 miles to any county library? We're in an area where we know there'll never be a county library, because there are two city libraries here that are grandfathered in under old, under laws that allow them to exist, and they collect their own property taxes for their libraries, and they're exempt from the county library tax. So we have a difficulty, because we don't have, on the eastern side, there aren't really well-established county libraries, not like Wildwood, not like the one in Oakdale, not like the one in Woodbury, large libraries that serve a great portion of the population here. But we need to have, we need to bring some sort of overarching concept of what this, what does it mean to have a Washington County Library when we don't have a library over here to serve the residents of Oak Park Heights, which on a per capita basis actually provide the greatest number of dollars to a library. They can't send their libraries to the libraries they use, to Bayport and Stillwater. I would support that. I would try to, either we have to create a system that allows all the county users the opportunity to have the resource near them.
Thank you. 45 seconds for Gary, who's asked for rebuttal.
Well, I somewhat agree with David, and that's the rub with Lake Elmo. You can't retain your tax base and expect to get full library services. We cannot afford to put a library in every town. I mean, all 32, 33 communities, that, you know, and you have townships that pay into library services. And, you know, we can go forward looking at whether we should have large regional libraries or more individual community libraries that make reduced distances. We're going to, down at the Valley Branch in Lakeland, there's intentions of improving that. So we are making those improvements, but it's difficult, expensive. We can't put a library in every town.
Thank you. And David gets up to 45 seconds. Go.
I think it's tragic with the city of Lake Elmo, the way that that's been done. They forwarded, I think, a perfectly reasonable alternative where they would provide the building space for the library, for the Washington County Library, free of charge. They would pay the rent in the building and keep the all the upkeep on that facility. I think that's a perfectly reasonable, but what they wanted from the county was 40 hours of it being open, and the county refused. They're at 25. That's a perfectly reasonable thing. I don't know where the county leadership is on this. Perfectly reasonable proposal.
You've opened Pandora's box. 45 seconds,
well,
Gary.
There's always details under what's, you know, the surface. The fact of the matter is this recent MOU that they tried to give to the county, they wanted the library to be remain downtown in perpetuity. Well, the county can't agree to that. They wanted to retain authority over, the quickest way to destroy the county library system is come up with a menu option to cities. You know, we have policies in place that protects everybody's equity. Is it perfect? Maybe not. We could always disband the county library system and everybody, every community for themselves. That's not good either. But it, you know, it's you know.
We're going to start to narrow this down. David has asked for rebuttal. 30 seconds.
I think what's difficult is that the agreement also, the suggested agreement also had a provision that if they, with 6 months' notice, either party could be let out of the library agreement. That doesn't sound like it's was so cut in stone that it couldn't be addressed. But I think we have to come back up to the county level. What is the county library system supposed to be? How does it serve the needs of all the residents of Washington County, especially those that pay into it? That's what the county board's supposed to do.
Stop. 30 seconds, Gary, to end a topic.
Well, I don't want to end this topic.
No, I end it.
No, I know. I'm just teasing, Margo. Our attorney told us that this six-month-out deal, if you're signing an agreement, you're going to be in there in perpetuity. So the six-month you could, pull out is not. If they pull out, we still have an agreement that we're going to be there in perpetuity. That was an attorney's recommendation, not mine. And just for historical significance here, Lake Elmo chose to pull out of the system. It never became before our board. There was still time to meet with the county board and see if there were better options available.
Stop.
Now, I have the Lake Elmo forums on Monday, October 17th, so hopefully some of you here, and maybe even one or both of you, will be in attendance where I hope that topic will be addressed. David, I'll begin the next question with you. The county has three veteran service offices to assist those who have served in the military and their families. Is the county doing enough to support veterans? What, if anything, would you change in the county's approach?
Well, the county is doing as much as it can do for veterans. We have a lot of veterans, but we don't have a lot of, at least in the Stillwater Oak Park Heights media area, we don't have a lot of current veterans that have served since 91 in wars. We do have a somewhat support with the Yellow Ribbon system, but I know in Oak Park Heights we barely had one veteran living in the community. It's an important resource to have. If there was a change, I would want them to have an expert that's actually proactively helping people, knowing the rules, proactively being able to steer people to the benefits that they have earned, instead of having to have a veteran ask the question. That it'd be, the interface is much more user-friendly. That's the hard part for veterans, because they don't know the right question to ask, so therefore they don't know what services they're entitled to. And that's really difficult to ferret out. We know we won't have a veterans hospital in the area. That's always going to be over the Fort Snelling Hospital for veterans. But getting the unique individuals that actually know how all these rules work, and are, when a veteran comes in, is proactive in making sure that the veteran has done all these steps to make sure they get their veterans benefits.
Thank you. And Gary.
Well, I'm startled that Oak Park Heights should only have one veteran, if that's what I heard. I mean, that's startling to me. But the veteran service officers, they're under great, you know, there's great demands, and they do a very good job, I feel. Could they, you know, could more things be done? Yeah, I think so. Veterans are true American heroes. Now, I don't care whether you served in peacetime or wartime. You know, when you join the military, you sign a blank check that you want to make great sacrifice on behalf of our freedoms and our nation. So I don't have a benchmark for veterans or a litmus test whether they served in active combat or not. I'm proud of every veteran. I'm equally as proud of the families that are at home keeping the family together.
Thank you. Now, David has asked for rebuttal, but because we're really running low on time, I had given you a minute and a half for closing, but add 30 seconds for anything you want to add to that particular question. And Gary, feel free to add 30 seconds to your minute and a half closing for anything that you felt we didn't address or that you want to reiterate. So go ahead, 2 minutes. And closing included.
Okay. I just want to clarify, this is a veteran from that has been involved in the military since 2001 or 2002 when we invaded Afghanistan. Interesting. Till now. So we've only had one veteran that asked for help in Oak Park Heights for Yellow Ribbon. One issue that didn't get chatted about is the resource recovery facility in Newport. That's supported by the 39% garbage tax. That was something that my opponent 12 years ago said that he was going to get eliminate because it was unfair. It's still there today. It was so poorly managed by the county board that it had the $5.5 million extra funds to be able to miraculously buy the facility without going through the county's capital improvement plan and putting it on the property taxes so that residents could pay. Could just help decide and write it off on their property taxes if those who itemized could. And what's going to happen with the fee now that the county owns the plant? Are we going to raise the garbage rates, require everybody to go until we lose in court again? So I would like to thank everybody for attending. This is this election is important for this district. I have visited nearly 6,000 homes right now, understanding the issues, understanding the mental health needs of the area. I don't think it's right that we, when someone gets in trouble and needs mental health help, that they end up in Lakeview Hospital for 30 days with nursing care and not get any psychiatric help. I think it's important that we merely make that change. So I will continue to visit about the last 3,000 homes that I have between now and Election Day, and I look forward to your view. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. And up to 2 minutes, Gary.
Well, thank you. I'm going to cut part of my... I'm going to thank everybody for being here. I just want to remind people that I have the support of all 12 mayors and town board chairs. I want to remind people that the county is in a good place. We are AAA bond rated by both rating agencies, the highest credit rating you can achieve. I would just like to say in response to the resource recycling, we paid $6.5 million cash for that. And, you know, there's always details. You got to make sure that you do the homework, because it's not 39%. We lowered it from 37.5% down to 35% in 2014. And we allowed that fund to grow in anticipation that RRT was going to get out of the business. And that's exactly why we let that fund balance grow, so we could pay cash like we did with the North Service Shop. We paid $18.5 million cash. So that was the intended purpose, and we had many, many, many public hearings and meetings on the purchase of the resource recycling plant. So I just want to point that out, and some other misinformation that I see on David's brochure, that we paid $2 million for the North Frontage Road by Osgood. Well, that's not factually correct. We didn't pay any. That was a state-funded project because it was a state-owned road. And so I would just like to say that we contributed $200,000 to reduce the burden on Oak Park Heights. And it's remarkable that anybody that looks at that after my opponent left office, we were able to work together and find solutions.
Thank you, and I don't give rebuttals on opening or closing statements, but thank you both for being here. Lots of replays on channels 15 and 16 with Valley Access Channels. Thank you for joining us in the audience and the viewers, of course, and on behalf of the Stillwater Gazette Managing Editor Jonathan Young, right to the second, Maya Jokanovic, thank you, and Beth Johnson, our forum organizer. Thank you very much, and vote on November 8th or before by absentee ballot.